Hi, my name is Scott Dougherty. I was the effects producer at CineSite for The Postman.
And I'm Tom Smith. I did the visual effects plate supervision for the Bridge City sequence.
My name is Gregory Ligi. I was the composite supervisor.
And Jay Riddle, who was actually the visual effects supervisor at CineSite for the project, couldn't be here today because he's currently on set for another Warner Brothers film. Starting here, we have the storyboards, Tom's well-preserved storyboards, I might add, from the set, which are kind of like a starting point in the filmmaking process in that the director can convey to a storyboard artist the ideas he has for the shot and the flow of the scene so that everyone on set has an idea of what the director would like to capture that day. These storyboards are drawn by David Negron, the storyboard artist on the film.
This part of the process is real important to all the creative people involved because you have a chance to go over different ideas, what might work, what might not. Those things all sort of change once you get up on the set sometimes, but it really does help for everyone involved to be prepared for that that shot when you get up there because things happen quickly and you kind of adjust as you go.
They also help down the line to kind of keep a unity of vision so that when we're faced with just the collection of the shot elements, we know what they're shot for, what their purpose is, and how they fit together.
You see, these have camera directions, which indicate where the camera will be moving, where the objects in frame will be moving, and there have also incorporated some photographs from the location, which help give everyone an idea, even before they get up there, what the set looks like, what the location is going to look like that they're going to be working with. Not all of these boards appear in the actual film. Usually you'll start out with a lot more images or a lot more shots, and depending on, you know, production circumstances or just changing in editing, a lot of these will be pared down or changed a little bit, so it's not locked in stone.
The second part of this process is actually shooting the plates. This was up in northeastern Washington, where the Boundary Dam exists. They built this really nice, elaborate set, which we actually surveyed with real surveyors to get actual measurements. We took those measurements later on and put them into the computer to generate our cables with which Kevin rides upon.
And even things like you see the water being discharged from the dam, those are things that had to be scheduled to fit around the shooting so that we would have that spectacular look in our shots.
The dam itself, the tower here, was about 340 feet from the water level, so it actually presented some elements of fear of heights and things like that working, where the crew were working without railings and had to have wires on them to make sure they were safe. As you can see, the particular shot was set up so the helicopters would come by and do the plates, and Kevin would actually do the stunts in the basket. He was real adamant about that he was in the basket. There were some other alternative plans to have a stuntman and a smaller basket in place to do that.
Here you can see what the scene looks like through the camera as it's shooting. You see kind of the flicker of the film.
We ran into some problems around the dam with the helicopter because the water, when it was discharged, created an updraft in that particular area.
Once the shooting at the set for the plates was done at the location, we actually went up to Warner Brothers in Burbank to their back lot and shot the green screen plates that would be combined with the backgrounds that were shot up in Washington.
It's advantageous to shoot on the lot because you can control all the lighting and all the situations to your advantage, make sure that everything works correctly.
One key thing, which you might have noticed on the monitor there on the set, is to make sure that your foreground and your background will fit together when it gets to a company like CineSite to put together. So they'll do like a quick composite on the set just to see that the camera motion is matching, the lighting is matching, and that when we get the elements, it'll work for the scene.
That the perspectives line up correctly. Sometimes it's difficult to estimate that beforehand, and if it's off, your eye will see that difference in the final composite and you'll know it's fake.
This shoot went on for about a week during the summer of 1997.
Yeah, we collected the information of the plate photography up in Washington to make sure that everybody was shooting with the right lenses down here and all so that it did look correct.
Now, most of these green screens, too, I believe, were shot VistaVision, and they had to be resized for the CinemaScope format of the film.
The DP, Steve Winden, came up with a creative idea to shoot all the green screens in shadow where Kevin was behind it, and that we would just have these on cranes and move them around following the sun.
That helps. The green screen, if you shoot it in the correct lighting, the correct aspect, gives you an even color green, which helps when you get to the computerized process, because it's a mathematical process, and gradations and things can interfere with the computerized extraction.
And here you can see some of our befores and afters showing the elements that were shot and how they're incorporated and put together into the final scenes. In this case, a helicopter, it was a live action rather than a green screen shoot, with Kevin actually hanging from the helicopter, and the helicopter is removed to tell the story, and then we add the cable later. You can see some of the red tracking markers above Kevin's head here, where we'll get the information of how far apart those markers are, and then we can track the camera movement and apply it to our background plates when we get the elements together in the computer.
So again, these go back to the storyboards to bring it back to full circle. We know we have to get certain angles of background plates. Kevin's going to be shot at a particular angle. So when we get in post, we've got it all together.
Here's some footage that we added a cable to extend. They couldn't get a cable that would go from the tower there all the way down to the other mountain on the other side. Here's an example of where, due to a story point, they needed to have snow on a mountaintop, which did not exist, and we went in and added a matte painting with the snow and some stormy skies in order to create that effect.
And this one is a sky replacement and color correction, which lends a post-apocalyptic feel to the scene. Here's a lion shot green screen. The background trailers and the trainer will be removed and replaced.
And then we add a map painting to extend the desert floor. We add mountain elements that have been shot, and actually rain and haze in the background and foreground to change the atmosphere a bit.
It was very difficult to match the matte painting exactly to that foreground that they shot with the lion.
Here's a sample of what might seem like a very basic shot that for some reason might not have been shot on location, maybe time constraints. But if you shoot Kevin and the donkey on a green screen, you can later add any background that you want.
And they did, in fact, switch a couple times on that shot for compositional and story point purposes.
Here again is an example. These backgrounds were used to enhance this live-action footage, where you had a very wide riverbed, but you want to tell a story that you're traveling in a certain direction or you're enclosed a bit by the mountain ranges. So we had to go in and add the mountain ranges, roto out some of these foreground elements, such as the lamp, just to separate them from the background element.
The foreground action here was shot in Arizona, but these mountains that we're using were actually shot up in the Owens Valley in California.
Now we're getting into some of our Snow Edition shots. Though the actors willingly got in the river, which is hard enough to believe, it wasn't snowing on the set, but they needed that snow to sell the idea of danger. We actually came up with a few layers of snow that we would add in the foreground and the background, plus a haze layer that goes behind them just to add some depth. This shot Greg worked on is one of the more difficult shots in the movie, where they didn't really have everything there. They had to shoot a green screen element for the foreground action. We took five stills that were taken at the location and pieced them together into a background plate large enough to accommodate the camera movement.
And these shots here were sky replacements, kind of what we call invisible effects. They weren't really supposed to call attention to themselves, they were just supposed to add a kind of uneasy feeling to the whole scene sequence.
effects like these are giving directors a little more creative freedom to do some things that they might not otherwise be able to do due to time constraints or other problems on the set. This is something they can do in post-production, even if they have an idea later on, maybe a month down the line, that they want to add or tell a story a certain way, they can do that. I just want to thank everyone for their hard work at CineSite, including Jay Riddle, Tom, and Greg here with me today. It was a great experience, and I hope you enjoyed all the effects work.